Hello.
And it was good.
No, but
I'm proud to come out here. Don't play my day, all right. He's gone.
I said, Kelly.
Okay, yeah.
Huge, huge.
Okay, lots of shells.
Yeah, play a joist. She was playing joist.
Oh, you bought, man, you bought three, two.
Yeah, but I mean, black, you know, black.
I mean, I've got a black.
I bought it, came up from there.
She's got.
One of them was bigger, and you could not tell that she wasn't as big as she was here.
So that's gone.
One exes and.
I will.
Two exes. I have lost two.
Well, I know, and there was a time that some of them fed you. But, I mean, they never, she never wore clothes at times. No, well, what I'm saying is, then when she lost weight, it's like they were all ripped and. And then she's lost weight, lost weight.
Girl.
It took me forever.
Yeah, it says I'm from that church, and I had to get something to eat, and it's hard to.
It's hard for them not to. She still looks an extra large.
Tom's gone, man, that's what I.
She can wear mediums and larges and tops.
What is this, a medium?
It may be a long.
When I was sick last year, I was 23. I got the same top, so I came to leave that. And I still got them on before I knew it.
Man, man, man.
Well, I got it.
Oh. Just that little.
Yeah. Where you go scoop? Where? Evergreen Boulevard, you don't want to see that green, do you? Basketball court, girl, please. Where you go? More cousin. He's a good one. Boulevard country.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How's your day? Did your dogs wake you up this morning? What time they get us up? 5:30? 6?
Well, I know.
Oh, I got up at 15 after 5.
Didn't need a dog, did you?
No, it was a dog.
Was the dog got you up?
She puts her head under my hand and goes, hmm. Hey, okay. Go let her out.
You gotta manage your doberman, right? She's cute. No problem.
They're all cute.
They're all cute when they're asleep, right?
Yeah.
She's not a bull ready. She's got something else with her. She sheds.
Subdivision dog.
We have the worst mix in the world. Molly or Maggie? Bark wolf, bark boxer, husky, and German shepherd. Look like a German shepherd. But wild as a buck. I chained that thing to our picnic table in the backyard in Ohio, and she dragged the picnic table in the backyard. Strong. I guess that was a husky in it.
They're all strong.
Good.
Wolf.
And the wolf, yeah. Anyway, announcements. No evening service tonight, so we can spend some time with our families during the Memorial Day weekend. We'll have a business meeting next Sunday morning during Sunday school, so that everybody can be part of the fellowship meal after the service. So, bring some food. Come hungry. If you don't bring any food, you can still stay for our fellowship meal. We always have plenty of food, and it's always good. Amen. doesn't sound like I am. Either I need batteries or something. That's what my grandfather used to call batteries. We'll put some batteries in there.
Batteries.
Isn't that how you say it? Who else says it like this?
I think it was Dave.
Batteries?
Dave.
Let's try these. How's that? Must not be on upstairs. Can you go check, please, madam? I'll talk to them when you get there. All right, prayer requests. David Baker, we need to add him to the list. That's Faye's husband. He's possibly facing back surgery. Needs to have it, so pray for him. And Faye and Joyce are in Mississippi. Faye's uncle passed away, Jerry Gregg, so pray for him. And Miss Christine's sick again. How old did we say she was this morning?
93. I'm just gonna listen to what he's saying. It's hot up here.
Anybody else we need to pray for? Who it is? Mary Dale Berryman. Diane, you see what you need to look for?
Lavalier.
Yeah. It should not be lit. The other ones are lit. That one's.
It's not lit.
Supposed to be.
Should be working. It's not on this end. Don't think it'd make a difference, but reach on this side of this left-hand side of the laptop and turn that, push that button in.
Push what button?
Not the laptop. Don't mess with the laptop. No, don't touch the laptop. To the left. Is that box?
Yes.
There's a button in front of it. A little red button. That's supposed to be for these mics.
You said in front of it.
No. One down below.
Not this one? Now what about this?
I don't think that's it anyway.
How about
if I just yell at y'all? Can y'all handle some yelling?
You sound loud enough.
I thought so.
Yeah, you.
Why don't you use another microphone?
I don't want to do that. Then you have to do the.
You got brown light, green light.
Hold that microphone like this. I don't like that kind of stuff.
Just put both hands on it. Grab it both hands.
Maybe I can attach it to my jacket. Y'all come down. We'll figure it out later.
This red button is supposed to be pushed in?
Yeah, but I don't think that's going to help. Did the light come on?
What light where?
When you push the button in, the light ought to come on in front of it.
I can't. I'm not bending over that far.
There must be something turned off.
Well, he's loud enough anyways.
Everything's going crazy this morning.
Now what?
It must be the computer.
Somebody get up here and tell a story while I fix that.
Yeah, Glenn.
Come on, Glenn. You know how to tell stories.
Tell about the one you told today. About the.
About who?
Yeah, sing us a song. Anything. She can't see because her light is on. Thank you. listen, it's one of those days. Do something.
You and Brother Scott just talked with, talked a few minutes regarding what it is. This lady bought a brand new Lexus car, brand new. She got home, carried it home, you don't hear to her. So she gets home with it, they get her letter, take care of home, she gets out. He leaves, and she says she'll take a spin. So she's trying to drive around, it's like she can't get to do nothing. She can't get, she cranks it up. She got to pull it in deep for daytime ride. So she's driving down the road, ride through the good. She stopped and goes to the next suburb. She gets back out of the car, and it's nighttime, so she put that knee up in the end for nighttime. It wouldn't go. So she called him back and told him to come out of the car, wouldn't go, wouldn't run. After she put it near, so she said, knee for nighttime. Done, blood. Makes sense. Judy, you need to smile, see much like a bird. Well, Scott, that's the one I got. I didn't go grace some water.
Oh, yes. Not proud of your hand.
Okay, we
can
start.
You agree? Anybody else we need to pray for? Well, let's go ahead and pray. Father, in spite of all that may be going on, we pray that you would help us have a wonderful service here today. Lord, we know that the people in the Old Testament and all through the New Testament had no buildings to meet in, but they still had a good time worshiping you. We pray that that would happen here this morning. Father, we didn't want to lift up Marinelle to you. We pray that you might touch her body and bring healing there. We pray for Miss Christine. We know that she's been sick off and on for a good while now. We pray that you might help her feel better. We do pray for David Baker as he's possibly facing back surgery. And Lord, you prepare him for that. Pray for Faye and Joyce and all the family, especially as Faye and Joyce are traveling back and forth to Mississippi. You watch over them and the death from. Father, we give this time to you. We ask you to just do a mighty work. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Oh, and I have one more. I do pray for the Dwight Phillips and family. I pray that you might minister to them today. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Well, let's take our hymn books and turn to hymn number 518. Shall we gather at the river? Hymn number 518.
Thank you.
first, second, and last verses.
Thank you.
Give y'all a second to find this one. It is in the Old Testament, 2 Samuel chapter 1. Today is the Memorial Day weekend. Well, tomorrow is Memorial Day. I guess we'll celebrate Memorial Day tomorrow. If you have a job, you'd be off tomorrow. Those of us who are retired, we're going to be working tomorrow. Especially the men. That's right. 2 Samuel chapter 1. Now, the reason I picked this passage, I was praying about it. I said, Lord, where in the Bible would we get a feel for somebody who has gone through losing a loved one? I was watching, I think it was Fox and Friends this morning, and they said, you know, it's like a funeral. Is the funeral for the person who died or for the family that remains? It's for the family. And he said this. He said, I knew I could be killed at any moment when I was on the battlefield. But he said, the guys I talked to, and for me personally, he said, I wasn't so much worried about what would happen to me if I died. I was concerned about my family. Now, I've never had this happen, and probably none of us in here have. You had a family member who was in battle, didn't make it home, and somebody walked to your front door, a couple of men dressed in uniforms, to deliver a message. I think when we read this passage, we'll get a feeling for that. So let's look. Number one, four steps in honoring those who have died to protect our freedoms. Number one, the report, verse one. Now it came to pass after the death of Saul, when David was returned from the slaughter of the Amalekites, and David had abode 2 days in Ziklag, it came even to pass on the third day that, behold, a man came out of the camp from Saul with his clothes rent, earth upon his head, and so it was, when he came to David, that he fell to the earth and did obeisance. And David said unto him, From whence comest thou? And he said unto him, Out of the camp of Israel, and I escaped. And David said unto him, How went the matter? I pray thee, tell me. And he answered, That the people are fled from the battle, and many of the people also are fallen and dead. So they're losing the battle, and Saul and Jonathan his son are dead also. And David said unto the young man that told him, How knowest thou that Saul and Jonathan his son be dead? The young man that told him said, As I happened by chance upon Mount Gilboa, behold, Saul leaned upon his spear. In other words, he was trying to end his life. And lo, the chariots and horsemen followed hard after him. So he was being pursued by the enemy. When he looked behind him, he saw me and called unto me, and I answered, Here am I. And he said unto me, Who art thou? And I answered him, I am an Amalekite. He said unto me again, Stand, I pray thee, upon me and slay me, for anguish has come upon me, because my life is yet whole in thee. So I stood upon him and slew him, because I was sure that he could not live after that he was fallen. And I took the crown that was upon his head and the bracelet that was on his arm, and it brought them hither unto my Lord. So here's the report. Saul is dead. Saul was the king of Israel. Did Saul and David get along real well? Not really. You know, Saul realized that God was going to make David king over Israel instead of his son Jonathan. So he kept trying to kill David. Did David ever have a chance to kill Saul? Several. But what did he keep saying? I will not lay my hand upon the Lord's anointed. So Saul was no longer a godly king. He may have started out well, but he ended poorly. And news of his death reaches David. I watched a movie a few years back called We Were Soldiers. You may have seen it. This colonel and a bunch of his men went off to battle in Vietnam. It was Vietnam or Korea? I think it was Vietnam. And all the wives were left behind. The wives became close because they're living in these barracks together. And so when somebody died, they'd send word to these wives that their husband had passed away, had been killed on in battle. But they had so many men dying, here's what they would do. They would give a telegram to a cab driver. The cab driver would drive up to the house and deliver the message. One day, Colonel Moore, the guy who was in charge, his wife was sitting in her home, and she heard the doorbell ring. And she looked through the door and saw a cab sitting in front of her house. Now, what would you be thinking? Every time the cab shows up, they have a telegram. And he's holding a telegram in his hand. And she almost fainted. She goes, "My husband's dead." And she opens the door and he says, "Ma'am, could you tell me where so-and-so is?" And she went ballistic. She said, "Do you know what it's like to have somebody like you show up at my door? I'm thinking my husband's dead." He said, "Ma'am, I'm just doing what they're paying me to do." She said, "Give it to me." And so she took the telegram and went to the house of the woman whose husband had died. Along the way, she had another woman come alongside her and say, "I'll go with you." And they delivered these messages together for a while. And then one day she got another message. It was for the woman who was always going with her, for her husband. And she said, "Who are we going to today?" And she said, "I'm sorry. Today is you." Can you imagine getting that kind of word? Even if it's two soldiers knocking at your door. Maybe you have had something like this happen to you. That happens a lot more than losing somebody in battle. You have a loved one who's out driving one night. They don't come home. A police officer knocks on your door. And next to that police officer is a chaplain. And you say, "What's going on? Mrs. So-and-so? Are you so-and-so's wife?" "Yes." "We have bad news for you." Or even worse, "Ms. Jones, do you have a son named Bill?" "Yes, I've got some bad news for you." Can you imagine receiving a word like that? Every person who has lost someone in battle has had to go through that report of hearing somebody that they love has died. And we, in Memorial Day, what are we thinking about? 3-day weekend. Some of us are thinking about the cookout. Glenn's smiling right now. Yeah. Instead of thinking about what did it feel like to the families when they got the knock on their door? What did they have to sacrifice so that we could have the freedoms we enjoy? You know, we take a lot of things for granted, don't we? It's very expensive to have the freedoms that we have in America. And some people pay the ultimate price. And their families, probably to this day, remember just like it was yesterday, somebody coming and telling them the news. Now again, David didn't love Saul, although he respected him. You know, we may not like the person who's in charge, and in many cases we don't. You may not like your boss that you work for. You may not like the President of the United States. You may not like who he is or what he does. But David knew one thing. You respect those in authority. He respected Saul because of the fact that Saul was the king of Israel. But now what really touched him, we're going to find out a little bit more, is not only did Saul die that day, not only did a lot of Israelites die that day, but somebody who was very close to David died that day as well. Number two, the retort or the answer, look at verse 11. "Then David took hold on his clothes and rent them, and likewise all the men that were with him." Everybody has tore their clothes. That's a sign of grief, okay? They're destroyed by what they've just heard. Saul and Jonathan are dead. This is terrible. "And they mourned and wept and fasted until even for Saul and for Jonathan his son and for the people of the Lord and for the house of Israel, because they were fallen by the sword. And David said unto the young man that told him, 'Whence art thou?' And he answered, 'I am the son of a stranger and a Amalekite.'" You know, if God tells you to do something, I'll do it. Were the Israelites supposed to make buddies with the people around them? Were they supposed to intermarry with lost people around them? No. What did God told Saul to do? Totally wipe out the Amalekites. You may remember the story. The king of Amalek, let me back up. Samuel said, "Did you do what God told you to do? Did you totally wipe out the Amalekites as God said?" And Saul said, "Yes, I did." And Samuel said, "What is the bleeding of the sheep that I hear? What's that noise I hear?" He said, "Oh, well, yeah, we wiped them out, but we brought back the sheep because we wanted to have a good sacrifice to the Lord." Now, what did God tell them to do? Wipe out every Amalekite. Wipe out everything that they've got. Don't make peace with them at all. and he brings back the sheep, and he tries to tell Samuel, it's so we can have a sacrifice. And that's where that very famous verse came from, where Samuel said to Saul, I desire obedience rather than sacrifice. Not only did he bring back the sheep, he brought back King Agag of the Amalekites, alive. Now what did God told him to do? Wipe him out. He didn't do it. You know what Samuel did? Samuel wasn't a man of war. Samuel didn't believe in fighting. Samuel didn't believe in killing. But you know what he did? He said, somebody bring me a sword. And he personally made sure that Agag died. Well, now, if Saul had killed off all the Amalekites when he should have, would he be facing this possibility of a man who is an Amalekite killing him? If you don't do what God tells you to do, it always comes back to bite you, doesn't it? I've known guys that said, God told me to preach years ago, and I didn't do it. And when I finally did it, I had to pay a big price along the way. If God tells you to do something, you should do it. So Saul didn't do it. So the retort was, here's what he says, verse 13. I am the son of a stranger of Amalekite. And David said unto him, how wast thou not afraid to stretch forth thine hand and to destroy the Lord's anointed? And David called one of the young men and said, go near and fall upon him, and he smote him, that he died. And David said unto him, thy blood be upon thy head, for thy mouth hath testified against thee, saying, I have slain the Lord's anointed. Now, did David just jump in there and do this? No. It says that all day long, he and the men had been doing what? They tore their clothes, and they fasted. Fasting is when you don't eat at all. So these men, none of the men ate anything for an entire day. Can you imagine? Glenn, you would pass out. You're like my teenagers when I was a youth pastor. I said, fasting is when you go without a meal. They say, you mean like for the morning? No. For the morning and the afternoon? No. For an entire day, sometimes. In the Bible, people fasted for 40 days. These men went without food. Why? Because they were so distraught over the word that they could not eat. Have you ever been at that place? You just are so heartbroken. They got this word that these two great men had died, and they can't eat. After the end of the day, he retorts and says, your blood be on your own hand. On your own head, and what? He had to put to death. Number three, the regret, verse 17. Now the reason, again, I picked this passage, I want us to be able to get into the hearts and minds of the people who have lost somebody on the battlefield. All right? We haven't gone through that. My dad served in World War II. He didn't go on a ship. He was in the Navy. He couldn't even swim. Paid a man $5 to take the swimming test for him. You know what he did? He was a radio operator. He was an officer, Lieutenant J.G. But all he did all day long was da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Y'all ever heard Morse codes? He could actually understand what that meant. We have one of these shortwave radios, and I turned it to that, and he goes, did it? I said, can you tell me what that means? Yeah. He still remembered how to do it. He didn't die in battle. My uncle was in the Korean conflict. He didn't die in battle either. I want us to feel what people feel who've lost somebody that they love in battle. So, let's read on verse 17. And David lamented with this lamentation over Saul and over Jonathan his son. Also he bade them teach the children of Judah the use of the bow. Behold, it is written in the book of Jasher, the beauty of Israel is slain upon thy high places. How is a mighty fallen. Tell it not in Gath, publish it not in the streets of Ashkelon, lest the daughters of the Philistines rejoice, lest the daughters of the uncircumcised triumph. What kind of man was David? Was he perfect? Of course not. But he was a man after God's own heart. He's suffering, and he wants the entire nation to know how to deal with suffering when it comes along. We need to have sympathy toward people who have lost family members in battle. A lot of people have died so we can have the freedom to enjoy. The freedom to mess up, right? The freedom to choose. The freedom to have a free nation. It cost some people a lot more than has anybody here in this room. So he says, I'm going to teach these kids I'm going to teach the entire nation of Israel how to mourn when the knock comes to their door. It may come to us one day as well. Verse 20, tell it not in Gath, publish it not in the streets of Ashkelon, lest the daughters of the Philistines rejoice. He says, when it comes to grief, keep it inside. Keep it inside. Why? Because if the Philistines find out, they'll know that Saul and Jonathan are dead. What will happen? People will laugh about it. People will laugh. Can you imagine people laughing at somebody dying? I don't care if they're your enemy or not. Should you laugh at their death? When Rush Limbaugh died, a lot of liberals rejoiced. That's wrong. When Ruth Bader Ginsburg died, I didn't rejoice. I felt sorry because I'm not sure she's in heaven. In fact, I'm pretty sure she died. Never rejoice at somebody else's death. But he was saying this. If they find out about it, they'll be laughing about it, having a good old time. They'll say, now there's no leader in Israel. We can go and defeat. So grief sometimes we have to keep inside. No. How long does it take to grieve? An hour? These men have all together taken an entire day to grieve. Are they over it already? You know, you associate things with things, don't you? If there's a doorbell ring with bad news, what do you think the next time the doorbell rings? Do you remember that bad news the time before?
Of course.
So he's saying, I'm teaching the entire nation how to grieve. I'm sharing the grief. Now, Diana bought a gazebo. I'm sure that she's going to help me put it together. If she was Hispanic, she'd say, no way, Jose. No, it's not going to happen. But maybe she'll get on the other end of some of these poles I've got to stake out and help me carry it. Y'all can't see her face, but I can. That's the face she just made. Not happening. Now, if you got something heavy to carry, do you want to carry it by yourself, or do you want to have somebody on the other end? The Bible says that the Holy Spirit is our comforter, means that He's the one who comes alongside of us and helps us carry a burden. Isn't that good? A shared burden is a lighter burden. He's teaching the entire nation, I want you to feel what I'm feeling. I want you to feel what these other men are feeling. We've seen great men die. And we want you to feel that as well. So, buckle your seats. As we look at this next section, you're going to feel exactly what David felt. You're going to feel exactly what all the people who have ever had somebody knock on their door and say, your husband died, your son has died, your daughter has died. Once you know how they felt, what will that do? How many of you have a problem with sympathy? Most men do. We're not real sympathetic, are we? In other words, let me give you an example. If I was up here hammering on something, and I hit my thumb, I went, yow! A lot of the women would go, oh, poor thing. That must really hurt. What would the men do? Right? Not much sympathy there. Now, we need to have sympathy toward other people. Imagine if you were the person that they came knocking on your door. How many of you have children that they come to your door and said, your son has died in battle. Your husband has died in battle. How many of you would then feel some pain? So as we're going through this Memorial Day, I want us to feel what those people have to feel. Number four, the reminder, verse 22. From the blood of the slain, from the fat of the mighty, the bow of Jonathan turned not back, and the sword of Saul returned not empty. He's reminding all the people of all the battles that these two men won. Saul and Jonathan were lovely and pleasant in their lives, and in their death they were not divided. They were swifter than eagles. animals, they were stronger than lions. We send our best and brightest off to battle, though. Many of them don't come back. And we say, well, that's just part of it. That's what they say about police officers all the time. Well, they get shot, but that's part of the job. No, it's not. No, it's not. When somebody gets killed, that is painful for the family. And many times they never get over it. So he says, let's think about them on battle. He could almost picture these two guys fighting. He could picture them fighting to the very end. Now, Jonathan was an interesting character. Let me brag on him a little bit, because that's why David really is crying. Again, he respects Saul, but he loves Jonathan. Jonathan was the guy that, when his dad said, we're not going to eat anything, and all the men were tired and sick and not feeling good, he took his armor bearer and they climbed a mountain and went up and fought off an entire garrison. He had a lot of bravery. When he found out that David was supposed to be the king, instead of being like his dad Saul, he said, it's God's will. And so he did everything he could to make David the king of Israel. He never once said, I'm the rightful ruler. I'm the one that ought to be on the throne. Who ought to be on the throne? The one that God puts there. Amen? Doesn't follow a line of succession like father, son, whoever God puts there. And so Jonathan and David were very close. One day, Jonathan found out that his dad was going to kill David. He got word to David. He said, David, I'm going to shoot an arrow. I'm going to get the young man to be with me as I shoot an arrow. He said, if I say, the arrow's this way, come back, then you know that my father's not going to do anything bad. But if you say, no, the arrow is behind you, keep going, then you'll know that my father's going to kill you. And so he shot the arrow and he said, the arrow's behind you, it's further, keep going. What did David know? Saul's going to kill him. He went against his own father so that he could get word to David, don't come back to the kingdom. Don't come back to the palace because my dad's going to kill you. They became extremely close. We'll find out just how close in a second. Verse 24. Ye daughters of Israel, weep over Saul, who clothed you in scarlet with other delights, who put on ornaments of gold upon your apparel. In other words, Saul had a lot of battles that he won. Here's what really got Saul mad. The women began to sing songs. And Saul wanted to be the hero of those songs. And they sang this. Saul has slain his thousands. But David has slain his tens of thousands. Now, should that be a problem? If you want the enemy dead, do you care who does it? But if you want the credit, you got a problem. He should have said, I don't care who does it. John Maxwell said, it's amazing what you can get done if you don't care who gets the credit. A lot of men will hire somebody who is not all that smart to make them look better. There's a giant church in Memphis, Tennessee. That was exactly what they did there. In other words, the pastor looked smarter than everybody because all those people working under him were not very sharp. John Maxwell was the other end of that thing. He said, listen, I want the best people working for me. He said, if I know more about youth work than my youth worker, I don't need him. I want him to be the expert. He said, people come up to me and say, boy, your assistant pastor preaches better than you do. He said, they ought to. They only have to preach once a year. I have to preach every Sunday. But he said, I don't get upset about that because if they're doing a good job, the whole church is doing a good job, everything works well. But not Saul. No. But Saul did some good things. He had slain his thousands. He'd made the country rich. And David is giving him credit. Remember that, people. Look at what Saul has done for you. Verse 25. How are the mighty fallen in the midst of the battle? O Jonathan, thou wast slain in thine high places. I am distressed for thee, my brother Jonathan. Very pleasant hast thou been unto me. Thy love to me was wonderful, passing the love of women. Now, believe it or not, there are people who say, well, David must be gay. Let me read that again. Thy love to me was wonderful, passing the love of women. Do you think David was gay? No. What he was saying was this. He and I had a bond that is so deep that I am heartbroken. When they killed my brother Jonathan, a part of me died with him. Now again, let's think about all those people in our country who lost a loved one in battle. We don't think about that. They're nameless to us. We don't know who they were. We may have an uncle or somebody distant that we heard about that died. They don't mean anything to us. But they meant something to their family. And if we become sensitive to their needs, we will understand what was given up. Now, why is that important? Why is it important for me to understand somebody else's sacrifices? If somebody sacrificed so that I can have, what should I have in my heart for them? Gratitude. I should be thankful for what they did for me. Do you think we have a generation that really is grateful for all the freedoms we enjoy? We say, all those young people. Well, not us. Do we really appreciate the freedoms we enjoy? You say, well, I do. Then why are you letting them go away from you? Why aren't you fighting for them? You say, well, I don't have a gun. I don't have this. I can't do that. That's not how you fight for them. You take a stand, don't you? You stand up for the freedoms that we have in our country. They're being taken away from us one by one. My brother was dating a Mormon girl. Mormonism is a cult. Here's what they actually believe. One day, if I'm a Mormon, and I live a really good life, I will become a god. I'll be a god myself. And I will get a planet, and I will get to populate my own planet. You say, well, that's just crazy. It is crazy. Now, if somebody were to walk up to me and tell me this is what Mormons believe, I'd go, go away from me. But they're not that dumb. They come up to you and they just very slowly tell you a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more, until one day you believe what they believe. My brother was dating a Mormon girl, and I heard about it, and I went, oh, no. I talked to my friend Jeff Smith. I said, what do I do? He said, I don't know, but you better do it now. Because if he marries her, you won't have a relationship. My brother, he said, married a Mormon girl, and we have nothing to do with each other anymore at all. So I bought a book on what Mormons believe. And I handed it to him. And I said, read this. He read through it up, and he said, oh my goodness, I didn't know they believed that. And he broke up with her. Now, little by little, over the last several years, we've had freedoms taken from us. Things that we can do without having to be approved by somebody else. In the last couple of years, we've seen that escalate. We've seen it increase. We've seen our freedoms being yanked from us quickly, haven't we? Do I have the right to buy gasoline at a reasonable price as an American? Can I? $4 and something cents a gallon? Who would have thought that? Was that a freedom? Now, at the price of $4 a gallon, do I have the freedom to go as many places as I would have liked when it was cheaper? Or do I have to think twice? Should I really go that far? So David says, I remember my best friend. He's dead. I sympathize with those who have lost somebody that's close to me. Verse 27. How are the mighty fallen and the weapons of war perish? He repeats that in another verse. The mighty have fallen. Weapons of war perish. It's a time for reflection. Looking back. Look what they did for us. Appreciating them. Every year about this time, there's a group of kids that go to the Arlington National Cemetery. flags and flowers on the graves. Have you ever seen pictures of Arlington? Those white tombstones, not much there. Rows and rows and rows. What do those represent? You probably have seen the movie Saving Private Ryan. Do you remember the last scene in the movie where the Private Ryan, he lived and the entire group of men that came to save him died? Remember the captain died? Just before he died, he said this to him. Prove it. Prove it. Show yourself worthy for all the death that took place so that you can live. Well, why'd they save that one guy? Why'd they send that whole group of men after him? Because he had some brothers who had all died. He was the remaining son, and if he died, the entire family was wiped out. And they said, we're going to get it back. Told Mom, we're going to get it back. Well, the last scene of the movie, he did this. He's standing at the grave of the captain that died. He turned around and looked at his wife. He said, was I a good man? She said, what? Was I a good man? Did I earn it? Here's the question for us. Are we good people? Did we earn what they sacrificed for us? How often I ask this question to myself. Would they have died for the country that we have right now? I kind of wonder. Are we being taught to love our country? I had girls in my Bible class in Moulton that would not say the Pledge of Allegiance. It's almost like there's a whole group of people now that don't appreciate our country. We still live on the greatest country on the face of the earth, but not for long. If we don't appreciate what we got, it will be taken from us. So in honor of those who have died, in honor of those who have sacrificed their lives, in honor of all those families who are suffering daily because somebody they love didn't come home, in honor of them, more importantly, in honor of Jesus Christ, as believers in Jesus, we need to exercise the few freedoms we have left and make a difference in our world. The day will come in the United States of America where it will be illegal to share your faith with somebody else. You say, I don't believe that. You better believe it. There are countries right now you can be arrested for telling somebody about Jesus. There are countries right now you can be put to death for sharing your faith in Jesus Christ. And here we sit, letting that be taken away from us as well, unless we stand. My challenge to you is this. Reflect on the sacrifice, not only that the men and women of our military have made, reflect on the sacrifice that Jesus made for us. And let's go out and make a difference. Do I hear an amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, as I think about David's loss of Jonathan, how deeply that hurt him, how an entire nation learned how to mourn. Father, I pray that you would teach us how to mourn during this Memorial Day season. Lord, that we would not simply think about it as a time of getting off work or getting out of school or whatever, but we would look at it as a time that somebody died that we might have the freedoms to enjoy our lives like we do today. Father, we pray that you would commission us not only to grieve, but to get up and to fight the fight, that we might make a difference in this country and ultimately in the world. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Open your handbooks this morning to hymn number 189, Footsteps of Jesus. I can't even read. 43 now. Thank you. Footsteps of Jesus. You can make a commitment where you sit, where you stand, whatever. Sometimes it makes a difference if you take a step out and make a public commitment. Here's what I'm going to do for Jesus. As we sing number 43, Footsteps of Jesus, let's stand and sing. Will you come right now? Thank you. tonight. Next week, we have our potluck meal, so bring something. Bring yourself. Glenn's got the chips.
That's chips and dip.
Chips and dip. What else do you need? That's a balanced meal right there. Any word before we go? Glenn, if you would close your prayer, please.
Dear Father, thank you. We'll spend the prayer for by us, by the whole country. Speak what's God's message up to everyone. All of the prayers of the name. Just be the one that's lost for too late in the name of Jesus. Be with this one, they grab it to it, but be careful. Just love one another.
I've just done
done one side, I still have to do the other side and the front. I'll probably be all.
You got that.
It's funny when you're.
No, I didn't hide the house.
When that storm came in.
The wind blew so hard, it's as hard as I've seen it blow in a long, long time. And I was looking out the back door and branches was coming off the trees and just.
What was it, my house?
The oak trees, you know, like. Little branches be around in a little finger and then a big cluster of leaves all over my yard. It was just scattered all over, so it was too wet the next morning to do it. And then the next day I heard the lawnmower going and I thought, be this morning's yard. I think it's my yard too.
Thank you.
So I went out and started picking up and he just come across and started mowing my yard. I hadn't cranked my lawnmower this year.
You should sell it.
There's a neighbor worth having, isn't it?
Yeah, his daughter is.
Girlfriend.
Son-in-law has moved down to him. They was really crazy, they was trying to. He's eighty-three or something and his health has really gone down. And I can hear that, you know, walking, he's more bent and stuff, but now he loves to mow and he's got really good mowers. And it takes him probably 30 minutes to do my yard and it takes me over an hour to do it.
Oh, wow.
But he comes across his yard and just goes through my front yard and goes through and does it all his time. He won't let me do anything.
Send it to my house.
Yeah. Well, I've got a son takes care of mine, so.
His daughter has been in, they've been dealing with it now.
We have to take care of our kids.
Which I'm really glad, because he's had some confusion problems with that. They come and they tell us that. It's like a doctor's appointment and he'll see the, like it went to bed early and he'll get up and he'll think, you know, it's time to get up and go to my appointment. Dark night, he can't do it. He said, I don't know. He said, I just wanted to.
Oh, wow.
Of course it's.
We
cut our grass.
Why was it Brazil?
Yeah. Because I was trying to cut and they were laughing.
Wow.
We don't cut circles.
Can if you want to. If you want to start the word, you don't want to get
bigger. They don't get bigger.
Well, my lawnmower is still a lot of time.
They said, Mom, let me do that.
They were like, wow.
Yeah, we want to start the word, y'all.
Well, this was beautiful.